Paul McFun of Doctors Without Borders will also join us as we take a closer look on how dire the humanitarian situation is in the African country. First, the headlines. Today's big stories: President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. now in Washington, D.C. for his meeting with U.S. President Joe Biden amid fresh tensions in the West Philippine Sea. The first batch of Filipinos who fled the conflict in Sudan back in the Philippines. And the Marcos administration creates a body seeking to address gaps in the labor market in time for the Labor Day celebration. Sounds of heavy gunfire echo throughout the Sudanese capital, Khartoum, on Sunday, despite an agreed truce. This as Sudan's military factions accused each other of committing ceasefire violations. The fighting, which has been running for more than 2 weeks now, has killed hundreds of people and wounded thousands. On Thursday, the warring sides agreed on a ceasefire that was supposed to last until Sunday. Meanwhile, repatriation efforts continue for Filipinos in conflict-torn Sudan. The Foreign Affairs Department says more than 400 Filipinos have secured a visa entry to Egypt. 114 have been left in Khartoum. They will be brought to Cairo and will wait for their flight back to the Philippines there.
We were able to book all of them hotel rooms. So in four hotels in Cairo. So makakapagpahinga sila at last. Grabe ang pinagdaanan nila. The desert became their toilet, while in the immigration facilities.
At least 17 Filipinos, meanwhile, have arrived home Saturday. And joining us now from Cairo, Egypt, is Foreign Affairs Undersecretary for Migrant Workers, Eduardo De Vega. And also with us is DFA Assistant Secretary Paul Cortez. So I want to greet you first. Good morning, Undersecretary De Vega. Good morning to you.
Good morning, Ms. Davila. Good morning to all.
Okay. And Ace Cortez, good morning, sir.
Magandang umaga rin po sa inyo, Ms. Davila.
All right, let's start first. Undersecretary De Vega, can you give us an overall view of the situation? How many Filipinos have already arrived? How many are being evacuated? The overall situation?
The overall situation is that, as has been reported, there have been actually over 600 Filipinos who have left Khartoum. The question is, have they all arrived in Egypt? No. The first batch we mentioned were a few Filipinos who left care of the assistance of the Greek government because of a small military aircraft, and we were able to request and we thank them for that. But actual repatriation trips from Khartoum to Egypt started several days ago, starting with a batch of 50 Islamic students from the International University of Africa, and they arrived, and they're still here at this Hotel Mallorca, where I am right now, and they will be brought home on commercial flights within the next few days, including today, Monday. There will be almost half of them flying to Manila. Then last Friday, another group of 344 actually arrived on the second batch. And after some days where they had to be processed at the border, they arrived yesterday here in Cairo. It was mentioned by Secretary Ople that they were given hotels. And interestingly, we sinalubong po namin sila sa Cairo border because the drivers didn't know Cairo. I mean, they were taken from inside them. Inside the area, no? So that's 114 more. And then right now, as we speak, finally There was a last batch of about 104 Filipinos aboard two buses who were still stuck at the Sudanese border. Because remember, there's a border, there's a Sudanese side where our embassy cannot enter, and the Egyptian side. Finally, they're the Egyptian side where they're being processed. And we hope today, Monday, very appropriately, Labor Day, they will be allowed with entry visa and enter and start boarding buses to Cairo. Remember, it is 3 a.m. here, minus 5 hours. So we still have quite a few days, a few hours, several hours before the end of the day. So we can be confident that they'll be allowed in eventually. Aside from that, there are other Filipinos who are departing on their own with assisted employers, and they usually enter to the Gustal border, another border place. And our role there is to secure them entry visas. And finally, there was a group which had been complaining, finally they're in, but there's still some more coming there. So we'll also work for that. And there is the Port Sudan route through the Red Sea. That's not the official repatriation route of the Philippine government, because it's a longer bus ride there, possibly more dangerous. However, when they do arrive in Port Sudan, and usually these are brought there by the employers, our consulate in Jeddah has been able to contact the Saudi government to allow them to board the daily Saudi military naval vessels, which go to the port and bring evacuees to Jeddah. And there have been almost 50 who either have arrived in Jeddah or are waiting transport. So it's ongoing. I think we can say that everybody who wanted to leave Khartoum has left Khartoum. Eventually, there may be a few more that will be coming in the next few days, because alam naman natin mga Pilipino, last moment maybe. Although interestingly, there was a group of 36 which was trying to secure through our assistance a bus ride home. But now they said their employers raised their salary, gave them security privileges. They're already used to the bakbakan in Khartoum, so they'll stay. Nevertheless, we'd like to reiterate the call for our kababayans. Please, if you can, you might still be 100 there in Sudan. Please do consider being repatriated. So it's ongoing, though. Okay. We're glad that finally, after several days of harrowing experiences in the desert border town, either the Egyptian border where there's more, nandun pa yung Red Cross. So, you know.
Okay.
And yeah, so it's ongoing. It's
Undersecretary. Okay, just an overview. How many Filipinos are in Sudan?
I can start before the conflict. Before the conflict, we only had about 258 who were officially registered. And the council,
okay,
the
embassy, but overall, even those unofficial, yeah.
750 thereabouts was the rough estimate.
Okay, 750. How many Filipinos have already arrived in Manila?
We are sure of at least 17 who have arrived in Manila.
Okay.
But this week, starting today, they will come in big trickles. Or starting tomorrow, because they're riding today, the plane. So every day for the next several days, there'll be 25 to 30 going home. So what's important is, out of the 750, we're sure of at least 609. Mm-mm. Or ASIC Cortez might have updated figures. Khartoum. So there might still be 100 plus over there.
Okay, but you are sure of 609, yes, Filipinos leaving already, or who have left Sudan?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So 609. And so far, I know that you had to prepare a lot of their documents because they didn't have papers. But in terms of funds to sustain relief and repatriation efforts, how is the Philippines doing with that?
Well, the Department of Foreign Affairs has a yearly budget of 1 billion pesos. That's almost $20 million. Mm-mm. For assistance to Nationals Fund. And that is why we continue to be the lead agency for these operations. Of course, the Department of Migrant Workers has a role there in reintegration when they arrive, no, and providing welfare assistance. So we have spent, and this is only the DFA, about $1 million, including the repatriation flights because of commercial flights, and of course, renting the buses. It's war. War is not convenient. Each bus cost about $30,000 for 50 people. So that's like riding a plane. But we're committed. We're not going to haggle. We're going to get whatever bus we could. So that's why it took that much, no? And of course, we have to house them in hotels. BMW is offering to help shoulder the costs. Again, this is a DFA-led operation, but that's it. We're all right with the funding. And we thank the Senate and the House for that.
All right, let me now go to Asa Cortez. Asa Cortez, you wanted to talk about, of course, the DFA is the leading operations under the one country team approach. Can you explain this one country team approach?
Correct. Thank you very much. You know, the one country team approach stems from the fact that the DFA's mandate, one of the DFA's mandate and pillars, is assistance to its nationals abroad. Now, even if there was a new law, Republic I 11641, which created the Department of Migrant Workers, the lead as far as international relations and, of course, pertinent to overseas Filipinos still belongs to the DFA. Now, the DMW takes care of temporary migrants, meaning Filipinos who go abroad to work on a temporary basis on a contract, while the DFA is taking charge of those who are permanent residents, students, and tourists. And for those places where there are no migrant workers offices, like in Sudan. Now, because there is no migrant workers office in Sudan, the embassy or the Philippines foreign ministry is the one that takes the lead after into all the operations pertinent to that. Now, when there are different agencies pooling in the resources, it still belongs to the DFA as an overarching, so to speak, agency that looks at all the efforts of the agencies, be they DMW, OWA, the DND, and so forth and so on. The DFA is the one that takes it, you know, sort of like conducts the whole operations while making sure that the other agencies as well coordinate their whatever resources they can pool in into this effort.
So it's fair to say that when it comes to repatriation, they all report to Undersecretary De Vega, ganun ba yun? Because you're the one right now in Egypt, you're on the ground.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. That's for coordination purposes, para hindi magulo, so that people know, the decision-making process, so that people don't make plans of their own, and then all of a sudden look at the, you know, differences in whatever it is that was planned. The strategy is to make sure that all of this effort is something that is concerted, something that is systematic, and something that can be efficient, especially for our overseas Filipinos.
Okay, Undersecretary De Vega, what is the biggest challenge in repatriating our OFWs? This is not the first time that the DFA is repatriating OFWs coming from a civil war, but in this particular scenario.
Yes. As long as the Filipino needs a request repatriation, because of natural disaster, civil war, like we did that for Ukraine, for example, and we were working on other places also. We're going to spend whatever it takes in order to repatriate them. But there's another process of repatriation. That is when the Filipino doesn't have the funds to go home. These are the deportees. In a way, that's another kind of repatriation. A lot of Filipinos in the Middle East are there and overstay their contract.
Yeah.
And if we don't shoulder their expenses, then they might stay longer in detention. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. So the DFA would cover that. We do, of course, have to emphasize that under the contract should be the employers who mm-mm. should be funding it. But if necessary, we will fund that. OWA, in fairness, OWA, we have to say, they have also an emergency fund for repatriation. But of course, OWA fund is under an OWA charter. And actually, they are limited to OWA members. By the way, we mentioned that the DFA takes care of overseas Filipinos who are not migrant workers. May I give an example here? For example, I'm here with Mr. Noor,
Okay.
Who is one of the first group. He's one of the first group. And okay. They arrive.
Can we show him? Can we show him there? Okay, can there?
Yeah, they're there.
All right.
Yeah. So he's a student. I mean, not all students are 19 years old. Okay. Uh-oh. So he was studying Islamic studies. So 50 sila. So obviously it's a department's role, and they'll be going home starting today. So they were the first ones who.
Bakit naman sa Sudan niya naisip mag-aral ng ano?
Po,
oo, bakit?
Because mayroong magandang dahilan. It's about the age. Sabihin niyo bakit po?
Bakit po kami nag-aaral sa Sudan, sa International University of Africa? Una-una po, yung International University of Africa po ay wala siyang age limit po.
Okay.
Kaya nagkaroon kami ng pagkakataon upang makapagpatuloy ng aming pag-aaral, makuha namin ang aming pangarap upang makapagtapos sa pag-aaral sa mataas na grade sa Islam.
Bion. Okay. Undersecretary, well, I'm glad to know he's safe. My other question with you is in terms of repatriation, it was surprising to find out that Filipinos still did not have possession of their passports. Di ba po binago na po yun? Ang bago na pong kalakaran ay dapat our OFWs are holding their own travel documents.
Ms. Karen, that has always been the rule. You can ask However, a lot of employers violate it. And that is why we sometimes put alert levels, including in Sudan.
Yeah.
When you put alert levels now, we discourage Filipinos from working in a foreign place. It's not only because there might be a war situation or whatever, but also because the conditions aren't good. And holding on to the passport is never, is never good. If you look at the passport, your own passport, Ms. Karen, may nakasulatan, di ba? This is property of the Philippine government. It should be surrendered to if requested. Now, what we are surprised about here in the Sudan case, though, is we know that employers in, for example, in the region, in the Middle East, often hold on to their passports. But here, the kababayan sa atin, a lot of them, not all, there was a news, siguro half of them, no? Didn't have them. So where were they? Because the employers apparently abandoned them, but didn't return their passports. So otherwise, sana may papel sila. That could have increased them or lessened the time that they had to wait at the border. Because the embassy...
So nasan ang passport? Nasan po passport nila?
Hawag ng employer. Maybe also it is a way para hindi sila umalis.
Oo.
Maybe. Para hindi sila lumikas ng bansa. However, we have decided to up the alert level of Sudan to alert level 3, meaning voluntary repatriation so far. And we're not going to lift it. I mean, ang sabi namin sa mga kababayan, pag umuwi na kayo, we have to look somewhere else. That has been a problem since the beginning.
All right. Ace Cortez, are there talks right now of a total deployment ban in Sudan? Because there was a ban in 2019 to South Sudan, and it was partially lifted in 2021.
Well, yeah. Thank you, Karen. Alert level 3 means voluntary repatriation and, of course, no new deployments as well. This is one of the policies that had been in place between the DFA and then POEA so that magkarugtong ang policies natin as far as alert levels are concerned. So when we raise an alert level, diretso na rin ang alert level pertinent to the deployment or the return of some of our workers to that particular country. May I also stress, Ms. Karen, Yusek De Vega had mentioned a while back about the funding. Every year, the DFA is given what we call the ATN Fund or Assistance to Nationals Fund and the Legal Assistance Fund. The Legal Assistance Fund, of course, is for those mga kababayans natin who need legal assistance, a lawyer, immigration penalties and all that.
Yeah.
And at the same time, we have the Assistance to Nationals Fund, which funds these sorts of contingencies, plane fare, repatriation, medical assistance, if need be, and so forth and so on.
Okay. All right. So my question is, do you think there will be a total deployment soon a total ban?
That will actually depend on the BMW. That's their purview, Ms. Karen. The ban, we do the alert level system and they do the deployment policy.
Okay. All right. I guess we can close right now. Undersecretary De Vega, is there anything you'd want to add?
Just to reassure the public again that we're doing everything we can. Unfortunately, war is never convenient. I mean, repatriation either. And it led to a huge inconvenience to our Kababayans who had to stay so long over there. But they are alive. They're alive. So we do that. And if you still need to contact anybody, you can use Messenger, PH in Egypt. Capital P, capital H, PH in Egypt. Egypt. Message if you have a kamag-anak that apparently it's not accounted for, and we'll be able to do something. But because there may be kamag-anaks that we don't know about. Because remember, the embassy only knew of the Filipinos there through contacts. But there may be somebody who's not contacting us deliberately or otherwise. So, kung may iniipit ng employer or what we'll do, we have to be informed about that. Thank you.
But all right, so that's pretty easy. PH in Egypt. Aze Cortez, anything you'd like to add?
Thank you very much. Yusek De Vega mentioned a while back about the arrival of our evacuees from Sudan, and they're coming in big trickles. We have 15 tonight, 34 tomorrow, and 24 tomorrow, all aboard commercial flights, which we have arranged for our Kababayan. So hopefully in the next couple of weeks, we see more of them coming home, reunited with the loved ones, reunited with their families.
All right. On that note, thank you very much, both of you, for joining me today. Undersecretary Eduardo De Vega, please take care over there. And our well wishes to our Filipinos. May they stay safe. Come home safely, sir. Thank you. And Ace Cortez, thank you so much for joining us. Thank you.